Some of you are speaking in French. My French is very small, petit peu. The lectures, of course, will be held in English, but I hope that's not a problem. If there's any question, please raise your voice and we try to explain. Okay, Dr. Scholl already gave you a few introductions into ITUT in general. I'd like to zoom in a little bit more on study group 15. You see here, ITUT is built up out of a large group of different study groups. I'm not going to indicate them all. You see, for instance, environmental and climate, performance, etc. We will zoom in this tutorial on study group 15, which is the largest one, as already indicated by Dr. Scholl. That's the one, optical transport networks, access networks, infrastructures. Currently, we have over 3,000 ITUT recommendations in force, and luckily you can find them all on the ITUT website. They are for free, and that's a very interesting and a good thing ITUT has decided to do. Now, how is Study Group 15 built up? We have different responsibilities, and Study Group 15 is responsible for standards on optical access and backbone technologies. Backbone standards are, for instance, synchronous data transmission over fiber optic networks, SDH, and optical transport networks, OTN. We have wavelength division multiplexing, WDM systems, and automatically switched optical networks, ASON. Also, access standards have been prepared by Study Group 15, like ADSL, VDSL, and in the access range, also PON and GPON have been studied and developed. And finally, on fibers, we have, of course, our recommendations on optical fibers and cables. Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you. And on fiber and cable structures and installations. And the last two will be the subject of my presentation. The next tutor of this week, Mr. Attilio, will have a bit more on the cable installation. You see, ITUT is covering a whole range of applications, ranging from real to long haul, including submarine, to metropolitan, regional applications, and up to access, either in metallic, in copper cable, or in optical access, as you can see over here. Study Group 15 is divided in three main parties. We call them working parties, and working party 1 covers questions 1, 2, and 4. Not going to read them all, you can see them later. Working Party 2 is involved with, amongst others, on the optical fiber and cables, so that's the reason I highlighted this one. That will be the focus point of my presentation. On cables and systems, that's over here, and on cables, I would say, is the question 16. And finally, we have Working Party 3 with, again, a number of different subjects. So this gives you an impression about all the activities which are present in Study Group 15. As I said before, it is a very big group, and also in meetings, there's a lot of documents going on if we come together in Geneva. You could say this is a kind of gearbox in which all those different subjects and questions are all interrelated in some way. We use the fiber specifications in the cable specifications, in infrastructure, in maintenance. So they are all related to each other. It's a real gearbox to introduce and make sure that the interconnections are still working. Now, a couple of years ago, already Study Group 15 decided that we needed a handbook on optical fibers, cables, and systems. And the first handbook was already published in 1984, and updates followed after that. ITUT has been active as you have seen in the standardization of optical communication technology already from the real beginning of this industry. However, it has not always been easy to find out what has been covered. And that is the background why this handbook has been published, to show the information as a general book in which people can quickly find their way, and from that they can dig into the more detailed specifications. So the handbook is intended as a guide for technologists, middle-level management, regulators, etc., to assist in the practical installation of optical fiber-based systems. Many experts have been working to have this handbook updated again, which was in 2009, and I surely have to credit Mr. Gaston Bonaventura, who has been the former vice chairman of ITU-T's TOGO 15, who has been a leading role in this group of ITU-T experts. Now, this handbook has the different chapters. I show them here in front of you. No doubt you have seen them already. Chapter 1 is on optical fiber characteristics. Number 2 is on cables. Number 3 on cable installation. Number 4 on optical splices, connectors, and passive nodes. Chapter 5 is on active and passive components and subsystems. Chapter 6 is related on optical systems, ITU-T criteria for specifications. Chapter 7 goes into the details of optical system design, and 8 is going into optical system applications. Chapter 9 is devoted to optical system applications in passive optical networks, and finally, Chapter 10 deals with the maintenance, safety, and the environmental aspects. So all these chapters will be highlighted the coming 2 weeks. The first first 5 in this week. I will take number 1 and 2, and my co-tutor will take care of 3, 4, and 5. And portion of chapter 10 will also be highlighted in the last in Friday of this week. And probably also one of the tutors of next week, Mr. Marcono, will take up some of the system-related aspects also on the coming Friday, already as an introduction to next week. Okay, well, we are here now to start with chapter 1. Before doing so, I heard already that some of you are already really related to ITU-T, but may I ask you a question? Who is really working in daily life with the ITU-T recommendations, for instance, the fiber recommendations? Can I see some hands? Yeah? So the question is, how are you really already using ITU-T recommendations daily in your working? Do you use them as regulator, okay, I see some hands going up. Okay, good. I saw that some of you are also participating to ITU-T meetings. I saw that you have been active, and I believe you said it also. You are going also to ITU-T meetings, I believe. Okay. So these lectures will help you to give you a further understanding what ITU-T gives you following the handbook on optical fiber cables and systems. Good. This first chapter on optical fiber characteristics has a couple of sections, and I will highlight them each after the other. The first deals with the single mode and multi-mode fibers. What is the difference between the two types of fibers? A short discussion on fiber design issues. I'll give you a little bit of explanation as a fiber manufacturer, which main manufacturing processes are available worldwide, so that you can understand how we as fiber makers are really making those glass wires. Then we have a large portion of to discuss on the specifications of optical fibers, and there we will highlight all kinds of different parameters which are important for specification of optical fibers. That will be continued in fiber attributes, in cable attributes, and in link attributes. This lecture is not going into the details of all the test methods. There are some separate recommendations on test methods. We are not going to discuss them here. I just give a brief reference where you can find the details of all test methods. If there's any question for you, I'm happy to help you, maybe offline, but it is not the intention to go deeply into the details of the test methods in this tutorial. And finally, and that's also important for you to understand, the different optical fiber types which has been specified over time by ITOT, and I try to help you why these different recommendations has been developed, to see that in a kind of historical perspective. So before going into chapter one, I added two introduction slides. First of all, to give you a bit of feeling, if we speak about optical fibers, optical is related to electromagnetic waves. And what do we mean then with wavelengths? Here you see a schematic picture how electromagnetic waves can range from very... Oh, that's going too quickly. I'm sorry. This one. Which is running from wavelengths which are very large, let's say the radio waves, meter waves, up to the extremely short X-rays. And somewhere in between, we have a region where our human eyes are visible for, and that is the range of the visible spectrum, which is running from about 400 nanometer to roughly 700 nanometer. It's not very good visible over here. That is about the range of what we can see with our human eyes as the visual range. Now, optical communication is just outside the red area. So that is what we call the infrared, or to be more precise, even the near infrared. So it's very close to where our human eyes can still see light going on. In particular, on multimode fiber, most multimode fiber systems in the world are running at 850 nanometers. So that is just outside the red portion we can see with our human eyes. Single mode fibers in generally are applied in the range between 1300 nanometer and 1625 nanometer. So that is the usual wavelength range. That is still what is called the near infrared region. Another introduction I like to give you is the principle how light can be propagated in a fiber. And that is schematically indicated here by a step index fiber. That means we have a core region, that is this yellow portion, and a cladding region, here indicated by this green area. And we have waves which are moving into this structure and are bouncing from one core clad boundary to another one. And how is it possible that these waves are being continued? That is possible by the following. I enlarged this area here where we have such a core cladding interface. I show that here. The yellow part is again the core region, which has a higher refractive index than the surrounding cladding. That's the green portion. So we have always to have light guidance in a fiber. You always need a higher refractive index in the core compared to the directly adjacent cladding material. And why is that? So suppose we have here a couple of different rays, and let's start with ray number one, which has a very large angle to the axis. You see that this angle at the interface of core and cladding is split in two parts. First of all, there is a reflection wave. We all know what this reflection is. And characteristic is that the angle under which the reflection wave goes away is the same as the angle under which the angle the wave came in. So both angles are the same. But there's also happening something else. There is another part of this wave splitting up into the cladding material, and that is called refraction. A refraction is something we all know from our daily life. You see that this angle is changed, and the angle reflects the law which was developed by a Dutch guy called Mr. Snellius in the 17th century. You see here that the angle of refraction is becoming larger if you go from the core to the cladding area. So the beam, more or less, is refracting away. And we see that daily in our life. If you have a glass of water and we put a straight pencil in it, it suddenly seems that there is a bend in this pencil, which is not really true, of course, but you see it happening. And that's only because the light ray coming from the tip of the pencil is not coming straight away, but is coming from another part of the material. And that is caused by this refracted wave, which has is leaving it under a different angle than it was entered into the core cladding or the water-air boundary. Is that clear? Is that clear why that is happening? Okay. So if you have such a large angle under a large a wave under a large angle, you will see that at each boundary the wave is moving forward. You will lose a part of this energy because this energy is not coupled back into the core anymore. So if you have many thousands of couplings, which may happen in a few millimeters already, then this ray cannot be guided through this core. So this is an example that this ray cannot be transmitting through the fiber. If we are taking then ray number two, we see that, which is at a little bit larger angle to the normal, you see that this angle then is so large that it falls equal to the axis. We call this the critical angle. And from this point on, and all waves inside this angle will only have a total internal reflection. So you don't lose energy anymore. The reflected waves are gone. So that is the principle how fibers can guide waves, only possible within the certain acceptance angle of the fiber. That is a kind of cone which can accept light. All waves entering into the fiber at a larger cone cannot be guided by this fiber. This is the principle how optical fibers are working. So again, here you see just outside the screen, the maximum angle is determined by this green one, which is just at this position. And you see that this sinus of this angle is equal to the square root out of the squares of n core minus n cladding. Is this clear that the fiber cannot accept a large cone? It's fully determined by the refractive index difference between the core and the cladding. And for single mode fibers, that difference is not so big. For multi mode fibers, you usually see that the index difference is much larger. And because of that, they can accept a larger cone of light being transmitted through the fiber. Also, an important issue is that this refractive index parameter is also determining the speed of light through this medium. And it's a very simple formula, as you can see. The speed of light in glass is the light speed you have in vacuum divided by the refractive index. So if you have a larger refractive index, the speed of light is in the glass is going down. If you have a small refractive index, then it goes up again. So with that, we as fiber manufacturers are manipulating the fiber structure, and we will see that in a moment in multimode fibers. So this is the principle how light guiding in fibers takes place. Is that clear? Is there any questions so far? Okay. Let's move on then to the first section of chapter one, which is dealing with the concept of multimode fibers and single mode fibers. When the whole idea of optical communication started, all fibers were of a very simple structure, what we call a step index fiber, which means that the core region had a constant refractive index, slightly higher than the surrounding cladding material, as you can see over here. So we call these fibers step index multimode fibers. And what we can see from here, if we launch light into the fiber and we launch a very small pulse in time, you see that this light is divided over different modes, different passes in which the fiber is guiding these modes. And we see already very quickly that the distance the different modes will travel through the fiber is also different. Those modes running through the center part of the core are the quickest at the end of the fiber because these are running all at the same speed, and this distance is much shorter than the distance if you make all those hubs. So that means that there is a broadening in time of the pulse. You see that the waves which have just at the acceptance angle, they have the largest way to go and will leave the fiber at the latest time. So that means that if you are launching a small pulse in time in the fiber, that pulse is smeared out, is broadened because of modal dispersion, we call that. Modal dispersion. And the step index is, from that point of view, the worst fiber, so to say. It shows the largest pulse broadening. It is for that reason that this fiber is hardly used anymore in data communication. You see this kind of fiber still being used for other applications like illuminating fibers or something like that. The industry found a solution for this problem of modal dispersion by introducing a new fiber called graded index multimode fiber. And in this case, the core region is now built up out of a graded refractive index. It's not a constant refractive index. It's constantly changing over the radius. And what's happening then is that you don't have any more those strict core cladding boundaries at which the beam is changing direction, but it is happening constantly. At each position, you have already a small difference in refractive index. So that means that there's a continuous changing of direction of the waves. And in this way, we see now, still we have different mode groups, different passes, but we can modify the refractive index in such a way that the total pulse broadening is being reduced. How do we do that? And that's doing by the following. Those modes which are running in the center part of the core will see the highest refractive index. That's clear. Because the refractive index is high over there, the speed of those mode groups is more limited than the mode groups which are running at the outer boundary of the core. They see only the lower refractive index, and the speed to those modes is higher. So there's a compensating effect in speed, is compensating the fact that these modes are traveling a longer way. So we still have a short pass and a long pass, but the difference in speed of those mode groups is different, and we can compensate for that effect. And that's the reason if we have a carefully designed refractive index, and we as fiber makers, we have to take care of that, we can limit the pulse reduction, or the pulse broadening, as you can see over here. In the step index, you have a very large pulse broadening, and we can limit that in graded index type of fibers. But that's the way fiber makers have solved this problem. However, still, there is pulse broadening. So these fibers will not give you the ultimate high bandwidth, which we will see later in single mode fiber. But the improvement compared to step index fiber is very challenging. Is this principle clear to you? That is the way how multimode, graded index multimode fibers have been developed and being used. And graded index multimode fibers are being used massively in datacom systems, so in all local area networks, so the short distance connections in data centers where you need a very easy connectivity to sources, so the tolerance do not play a big role, there you will find multimode fibers. But for that reason, it's also the reason why in the telecom you don't find so much multimode fibers anymore. We had only multimode fibers in the very beginning of the optical telecommunications, so in the late 70s and the early 80s, then we had multimodes starting up optical communications, but nowadays that has completely changed over to single mode fiber. If you are going to reduce further the refractive index difference between core and cladding and also make the core much smaller, at a certain time only one mode, one waveform is fitting into this structure. So you don't have the multiple modes and the multiple ways of traveling anymore. You have only one mode, so the whole modal dispersion is disappearing. That is the background why single mode fibers has been developed. So the big issue, the big improvement from going from multimode to single mode fiber is that you have lost this pulse broadening, which are always present in multimode fibers. And that's the reason why these single mode fibers became very popular from the beginning of the 80s. They completely took over the earlier multimode fiber connections. Of course, this has a price, of course, because the mode field diameter is much smaller, so the connectivity is not so easy as compared to multimode fibers. But that is doable because you can share those single mode fibers at high bit rates. You can share that with many, many customers who are all contribute in the payment of more expensive sources. And that's the big difference why in the data systems, where you have direct connections from one computer to another computer, there you have to have very cheap solutions. So that's the reason why multimode fibers are used in datacom and why single-mode fibers are generally used for telecom applications. Is that clear? Yeah, please.
If we are looking at using multimode, for example, for connecting buildings, what should be the maximum distance? Yeah, for multimode.
So for multimode fibers, I said already, they are mainly used for datacom systems. Let me refer to let's say, the high-end multimode fibers which has been developed, which are developed for 10 gigabit Ethernet applications. There we see different qualities. And like for instance, OM3 multimode fibers are developed for 10 gigabit Ethernet over 300 meter. That is usually for the datacom world enough distance already to build up a LAN structure in a building or in a data center. There are a new group of fibers, OM4 fibers, which extend that distance even up to about 550 meter. So typically, a few hundred meters is the application range for multimode fiber. Is that okay? Okay. Any more questions so far? Okay. Then, in section 2 of the chapter 1, we see a couple of different fiber designs, and now we completely switch over to single-mode fibers. What you can see over here is a group of what we call dispersion unshifted single mode fibers. We'll come back later what we mean with that. And we have also dispersion shifted single mode fibers. Going to the most similar, most standard used single mode fibers, which is the group of dispersion unshifted fibers, you see here a design which we call a mesh cladding design, which means that the directly adjacent cladding you see over here, adjacent to the core, is at the same refractive index level as the outer cladding refractive index. That's the reason why we call these fibers matched cladding. In contrary to that, in the early days, we also had so-called depressed cladding fibers, which means that the directly adjacent cladding to the core was at a different refractive index level as the outer level of the cladding. These designs were made by the idea that the attenuation could be a little bit lower in so-called depressed cladding. What you can see here is that you see here an increase in the refractive index. And we as fiber makers, we realized that by adding a kind of dopant to the glass. And usually we are using germanium oxide to raise the refractive index of this area. So in our fiber production process, we not only make silicium oxide, but in those areas where we need the core, we add a dopant called germanium oxide, and then the refractive index goes up. That's the way how we make profiles in a fiber. However, germanium oxide has also a negative effect on the attenuation. So if you have a lot of germanium oxide in your core, then also the attenuation goes up a little bit more. And in those early days, we saw that if you are using a depressed cladding, and here you only have half the core to be built up out of germanium oxide, so less germanium oxide in your core, we saw that this was an idea to have a lowering and a reduction of the attenuation level. Nowadays, we do not use this design so much anymore. But in the past, certainly in the 80s, 90s, we were using depressed cladding. My company also started single mode fibers with a depressed cladding structure. But nowadays, we have completely switched over for standard single mode fibers on the mesh cladding design. Now, it is possible to go even one step further and to have no germanium oxide at all in your core. And those fibers we call pure silica core, because there is no dopant at all. Only pure silica is introduced over here, and you only need to make a larger depressing around it. Now, making a depressing in the glass structure is made by adding another dopant called fluorine. So we have germanium oxide to raise the reflective index, and we have a dopant called fluorine to reduce the reflective index of the glass structure. These fibers are meant to be to obtain the lowest attenuation possible. So these are, we will see that later, are, for instance, suited for fibers fulfilling GE654 low-loss applications. However, it is quite difficult to produce these fibers, so the costs associated to them are higher. They are only used in very special applications, for instance, in submarine applications where you need a very, very low attenuation to have, for instance, repeaterless connections. So this is a special group inside the group of dispersion unshifted fiber. The large bulk of fibers being installed in the world is the group of mesh cladding fibers. Now we will see later that if you manipulate the core design a little bit more by increasing the reflective index heights and making some structures like here, you can change the chromatic dispersion. I will come back to that later. And then you can create a different group of called dispersion managed fibers like this shifted fiber. I'll come back to that later. But this gives you in a brief overview the different fiber types which are available. And I have to say to you that in the international standardization, we do not describe the profile. So in none of the standards in ISC or in ITU, we put a definite description of the profile itself, because that would limit some of the manufacturers also. So only what we are doing in standards, we are specifying related parameters, which are, for instance, mode field diameter, chromatic dispersion. So all those parameters which are directly related to the transmission characteristics of the fiber, these parameters are standardized, but not the way in which they are obtained, whether it is a mesh clad or a depressed. You do not see that in the IDUT recommendations or in the ISC standard. And that gives, again, the fiber manufacturers the freedom to optimize their processes to a certain fiber type. And it doesn't matter so much as long as the mode field diameter is the same of different makes of fiber, it doesn't influence the transmission characteristics. Okay? I think this is quite important to realize that only related parameters are present in the different standards. Now then, a few words about how optical fibers are being produced. And to start with, fiber makers start with a making of a big, in the sense of a broad glass preform, but that's rather short. And worldwide, we see four different manufacturing processes. The oldest one is the MCVD process, and nowadays there's a lookalike called Furnish CVD instead of modified chemical vapor deposition. It's an inside tube process and based on thermal energy. I will give you in a moment a picture of such a process. Then we have a second process called OVD, outside vapor deposition. And this is, as the name already indicates, an outside process. It does not use any tubes at all. It is also a thermal-based process. A Japanese look-alike has been developed called VID, vapor axial deposition. Again, it is an outside process like OVD. It's also based on thermal energy. And finally, in my company, PCVD has been developed. It's called plasma activated chemical vapor deposition. It's like MCVD, also an inside tube process. I will show that in a moment. And the difference is that we don't use thermal energy, we are using microwave energy. In all those preforms, we have a kind of chemical process going on. So from a gas called silicon tetrachloride, which is reacting with oxygen, we create SiO2, that is quartz. That's the basic step we make. And there's a rest product, a chlorine gas, which is being neutralized in all our factories. To make the core refractive index become higher for light guiding, as I explained to you, we have here one of the dopants indicated. We need germanium oxide being added to the quartz, and we make that out of germanium tetrachloride, that is a gas, which again reacts with oxygen to GeO2, and this is built in into the glass structure. And on those places, the refractive index will be a bit higher. As I said before, this is a batch-wise process. So each time we make a preform, we grow it over a certain length. It has a length of maybe 1 to 2 meter length, a certain dimension, which later on is then drawn to a very thin but long wire. Some pictures of the different processes. I showed you here first the outside processes. OVD is indicated over here. You see here that it's a thermal process, so it's a burner system. And in this burner, hydrogen-oxygen burner, germanium oxide can be, or germanium tetrachloride can be added. And here the chemical reaction already takes place. So SiO2 and germanium O2 is created here in this hot area of the burner. And then small particles, like sand particles, so to say, we call that soot, are then deposited on a first starting mandrel. And by moving the burner up and down, we can grow layer by layer, we can grow the preform in thickness. And of course, in the center part, we need the core region. So in this is the first layers which are here deposited in this process need the higher germanium oxide. And in the outer region, which is later the cladding material, we don't have any germanium oxide anymore. What is created here is a what we call a soot preform. That is a non-transparent glass. So it's a white powder preform, I could say it in this way. It's not yet transparent. And later that will be transformed to a melting down to a transparent glass. Then the other process, which is a bit a look-alike, which is developed in Japan, is the VID process. And here the same more or less is happening. There's a burner system. The gases are added over here, also the silicon tetrachloride, germanium tetrachloride. So here the chemical process takes place, and SiO2 and germanium O2 particles, as sand particles, are deposited on a starting mandrel. But then it's the preform is going in the axial direction. We have seen here that this process is going in the radial direction. In the VID process, you see that the preform is going in the axial direction. That's the reason why this process is called VAD, A for axial. Then inside tube processes, MCVD process, that is the oldest process which has been developed ever. We see that this process is taking place inside a tube. So that is the big difference compared to OVD and VID. So the chemical reactions are fed into the tube, and then on the outside we have a burner system, and the heat from the burner has to pass the glass of the tube. The gases are heated up, and then the chemical reaction takes place. SiO2 and germanium O2 are formed, and they are deposited on this part, on this position. And when the burner is moving, the soot part is melted down into a transparent glass layer, as you can see over here. A drawback of also this process is that quite a lot of this material is also blown out, so the efficiency of the process is not so high. Then the PCVD process, developed in my company, is also, like the MCVD process, a process which takes place on the inside of a tube. So we start with a substrate tube to which on the inside we are adding the different gases. And now we don't use a thermal energy source anymore. We are using here a magnetron. So some kilowatts of microwave power is fed through a Golf pipe into a resonator. And from the resonator, this energy is coupled into the gases through the glass wall. And that is the advantage of this process without any loss. If you compare the MCVD process, there is always thermal loss when the heat is passing the glass substrate tube. We don't have that point in the PCVD process. The high frequency energy can pass the glass without any losses. So that is the big advantage. And that's the reason why in this process, this whole assembly can move very quickly up and down the tube, all at each position depositing very, very thin layers of silicon oxide. While in the MCVD process, this process is running very, very slowly, because otherwise there's too much loss in the glass wall. So from this point of view, we can distribute and deposit very thin layers. We do that in many thousands of layers, so we can deposit it and realize fibers with very complicated refractive index structures. So these are the four different main processes to make a preform, which is still in this position in the form of a tube. The tuple has been increased, but it is still a tube. So we have to do a little bit more to that. And that is happening in the next phase. That's what we call collapsing or consolidation. The inside tube processes, they are all tubes, as said before. We have increased the wall thickness with the new glass deposited on the inside. We are now going to treat them at a very high local temperature, because of which the glass starts a little bit melting. And due to surface tension, then the glass wants to take the smallest dimension. Like in a water drop, it's always around because of the surface tension. This is also happening in this glass at those, let's go too quickly. In this position, the glass is melting a little bit and then takes the smallest diameter and then shrinks a little bit. So this furnace is passed on a couple of times, and each time the tube is decreased in diameter, and finally it's completely collapsed and we have the solid rod. So this is a step to change the tube structure into a solid rod structure. And we need that because a glass wire in itself is a thing, but it is a solid rod, of course. Something similar is happening for the OVD and the VD processes. We have seen that the product of those processes is, first of all, a soot preform, a kind of, let's say, a glass dust preform. It's not transparent. It's a white powder preform, which is then in a furnace melted down to a transparent glass, which later on can be drawn to a thin fiber. Are there any questions so far on those manufacturing steps? Okay.
I have one question, please. Yes. I want to know, between that all manufacturing process, what the process is the best?
Well, I'm here on behalf of ITU, so I will not promote our own process. I think each process has its pros and cons, of course. And we in Draka, we believe that our process is the best, but if you ask someone from Corning, they will say that their process is the best, and someone from Japan will think their process is the best. I think each process has its pros and cons, as said, and I think it's difficult to say there's only one the best, because otherwise all those processes would not exist anymore. They all are existing, they all are producing in an economical way fibers to the market. So I cannot say there is one the best.
Okay. What process everybody use in the world between...
Again, I think all those processes are delivering fibers to the market, and each company has decided to optimize their own process, of course. And people are using MCVD, they have improved that and introduced FCVD, for instance. The Japanese companies have further improved VAD processes. Corning, who is using OVD, has improved their processes. And similar for us, we have improved PCVD. So, but we are all capable to deliver fiber into the market in a very economical way.
For me, if I understand, the choice of process depends to the company.
Yeah. Okay. Different companies have different fibers, but all those fibers, and that's the importance of standardization, they can work together. All those fibers can be combined because of compatibility. And that's, of course, crucial, that if you even have, you have fibers from different manufacturing backgrounds, you still can use them to each other based on parameters which has been standardized. So that we did in ITU and in ISC, that we recognize which are the main parameters we need to standardize in order to have this compatibility between fibers.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. So there was another question.
Thank you. Actually, I think that the question is might be a bit premature to be asked. With all those four manufacturing methods, I was wondering how one is going to make sure that he meets the requirements that that are stated by the standards of the market. Is there any stage where the testing is made so that you make sure that whatever method that you're using, you meet the requirements?
Yeah. Well, I think here, per principle, the status of standardization is important. All people involved on that were sitting around the table, so both the manufacturers as well as the operators, the users, and they all decide over those years of standardization which parameters are important for operating networks and in combining fibers to each other. And these set of parameters has been introduced into our specifications. So at the end of my story, I will show you two recommendations showing the main parameters which are important to build up networks with these fibers. But it is an interaction between the manufacturers on one hand and the operators, the users on the other hand. And that's important, certainly in ITU, where we have operators around the table and also the manufacturers on the table, that we have a good discussion with each other, which is important to standardize and to which limits, specifications limits. And of course, during the manufacturing, we take care that the fibers we are delivering to our customers, which for us is first of all the cable manufacturer, of course, and the cable manufacturer then goes to the final user, that all these specifications are checked, that we have fibers delivering to our customers, are completely fulfilling the international specifications. Okay. Any more questions? Good questions. Okay, so we have seen now the level of preform manufacturing. Finally, what we have to do, we have to make those very thin but long wires, glass wires, and that we are doing with a preform drawing. And I show you here a couple of pictures out of my factory. You see how here the big preform is entering in later in the furnace. Schematically, you see here how a drawing tower is built up. In the top, you have a furnace where the glass is heated up to over 2,000 degrees centigrade. So slowly, the preform is lowered into this section. You see, for instance, this picture is made on top of the furnace, the furniture over here. Because of the high heat, there's a lot of light in this furnace. You see that is still visible also in the big preform on top of that. And then, because of the heat, the glass is melting down and is finally entering and leaving the furnace at a diameter of 125 micron diameter. We can measure that. We have here a measuring device that we carefully measure the outside diameter of the glass wire passing by. We can use that that measurement also to have a system to keep the cladding diameter within control. For instance, if the glass diameter would be a little bit too high, too large, we can increase the speed of in which we draw the fiber, and then the too high diameter is reduced again. If the diameter is too small, then we lower the speed a little bit. So in this way, we have a regulation mechanism in our drawing towers that we have a constant diameter within 1 micron, or even tighter than that. So this is the first measurement we are doing on the bare glass. So again, this is all bare glass. And then we are entering into two places where we are adding the coating material. We do that in line. And it is, of course, it's very important that we have this facility because a glass wire in itself is extremely strong. A glass wire is of this dimension is stronger than a steel wire of the same dimension. You should recognize that glass is stronger than steel. However, it should nowhere find a crutch in the glass, because then the strength is completely gone. So you have to protect the bare glass with a coating which is applied on these two places. Of course, the temperature of the fiber over here is very high, it's around the 2000 degrees, but you cannot enter at that temperature the coating devices, so you need a cooling down of the fiber. And nowadays, drawing towers are tens of meter high, 20, 30 meter high maybe. And most of that is the cooling down area of the fiber, going down from 2000 degrees to room temperature. So most of the region of the length of the drawing tower is in this section. That's the cooling down region. Then we are entering into a coating device. And as a liquid, we apply a kind of UV acrylate around the fiber, which is leaving the fiber and kept on the fiber, and then it is cured under UV light. So there's a film of UV acrylate leaving this dye, which is immediately cured, and then a second layer of coating is added. And the same principle as a liquid, a layer is taken down and then cured under UV light. Then immediately you can touch the fiber. So we have inline coating of all fibers. That's done everywhere in the world. Usually, we have, nowadays in modern production of fibers, we have a two-layer primary coating. We still call it the primary coating, but it is a two-layer. The inner layer, so the first coating, is a more soft UV acrylate, and the second layer is a more hard acrylate. So the hard acrylate is meant to really help the fiber against the cool outside world, so to say. And the inner coating, the soft one, is to position the fiber a little bit. In this way, if there are forces entering on the fiber, we can neglect it as much as possible. And here, for instance, microbending effects are heavily influenced by making the right choice between the soft and the hard coating materials. I'll come back to that later. But in all fiber manufacturing places, you will see this double layer coating system. And then the fiber is wound up on big drums, as you can see over here. You see some pictures over here. And then the fibers are sent to the measurement department for characterizing the fiber. The speed of fiber drawing may be dependent from company to company. For instance, in my company, we are running single mode fibers at about 1200 to 1500 meters per minute. That's the speed in which we are drawing the fiber of the big preform. Okay, any questions on fiber drawing? Okay. I have a look on the time. Maybe this is a good timing now. It's a 12:15. That we stop now for the lunch break. I have heard the time that we are going to reconvene. Has anybody an indication of the time? Do you know what time we're going to reconvene? What is the time for the lunch?